SpaceX is at it again. They've created a new Starship capable of orbital travel, which is something the previous Starship was unable to do. How did SpaceX make the new Starship booster capable of flying to orbit? If you want to find out, then keep watching. Before we go any further, I'd appreciate it if you could give this video a thumbs up and subscribe to this channel. Thanks for doing that, and let's get started. The most recent prototype of SpaceX's Super Heavy rocket, which is the first of its kind and designed to house 33 brand new Raptor V2 engines, has been completely stacked. Super Heavy is more straightforward than Starship. Nonetheless, it is in many other respects just as sophisticated and innovative as Starship. Super Heavy was designed to launch Starship's gigantic, eponymous upper stage on its trip to orbit. Ignoring SpaceX's unusual plans to have boosters land on enormous mechanical arms installed on a skyscraper-sized tower, the Super Heavy is, simply, a large vertical launch, vertical landing liquid rocket booster. This is a type of booster with which SpaceX already has extensive experience, thanks to the Falcon 9 and the Falcon Heavy. A single stage of the Starship Super Heavy, at around 69 meters or 225 feet from tip to tail, is almost as tall as a complete two-stage Falcon 9 or Falcon Heavy rocket. This stage is just one of the two stages that make up the Starship. At a width of 9 meters, about 30 feet, a single Super Heavy booster, which is essentially a big steel tube, ought to be capable of storing at least 6 or 7 times as much fuel as the Falcon 9, and around 2 to 3 times as much as Falcon Heavy. Engine count and peak thrust are similarly staggering. These engine-related capabilities have been significantly expanded thanks to SpaceX's most recent Super Heavy prototype, known as Booster 7, or B7. Booster 7 is intended to sustain as many as 33 Raptor V2 engines, rather than the 29 Raptor V1 engines already installed on Super Heavy B4. While the V2 design significantly amplifies the Raptor's design to make it easier to build, install, and operate, it also significantly boosts maximum thrust from around 185 tons to at least 230 tons. This allows the V2 design to make the Raptor significantly easier to build, install, and operate. In theory, Booster 7 may deliver at least 40% higher thrust than Booster 4 if Super Heavy B7 is fitted with the full complement of 33 Raptor V2 engines capable of operating at that claimed thrust level. On the other hand, B4 has not yet attempted even a single static fire. After more than a half a year at the orbital launch site, SpaceX has not taken Booster 4 through a single full wet dress rehearsal, a launch simulation just shy of ignition, or static fire test. This has led many people to believe that the prototype is likely on its way toward early retirement. SpaceX finally has a feasible substitute that's capable of both taking the flame forward and kicking off the qualification of the first prototype planned to use Raptor V2 engines. With Booster 7 now possibly just a week away from being fully ready, SpaceX finally has a viable replacement. Other modifications to the design of Booster 7 include slimmer raceways, external conduits that protect wiring and smaller plumbing, a different arrangement of pressure vessels, hydraulic power units, an umbilical panel installed on its aft, and significant modifications to the aero covers that slot over the aft hardware. Booster 7 will be launched into space on an Atlas V rocket. After installing its Raptor engines, the two modifications to Super Heavy Booster 7 that are considered the next most significant are the addition of large internal header tanks that are used to store landing propellant, and the installation of a pair of aero covers that resemble strakes. It's now anticipated that several new aero covers with sharp edges will be able to be slotted over the top of two new pairs of 5 composited overwrapped pressure vessels, or COPVs. These COPVs are located around 1/3 of the way up the Booster 7's tanks. They will probably perform some of the same functions as strakes, which are structures resembling permanent wings designed to improve aerodynamic stability. In comparison, the Super Heavy B4 has 4 sets of 2 COPVs that are evenly spaced around the engine section's exterior. Finally, it seems like SpaceX has upgraded Super Heavy Booster 7 with a complete set of internal header tanks. This indicates that the booster should now be able to store all the landing propellants required in separate tanks. This results in a significant reduction in the amount of pressurization gas that is required, and it also makes it much simpler to guarantee that the Super Heavy's Raptor engines are supplied with an uninterrupted flow of propellant during complex maneuvers that take place in space and the atmosphere. After SpaceX chose to convert the tank vents on the Super Heavy into maneuvering thrusters, header tanks should also be able to reduce the risk of liquid fuel being inadvertently released. At the same time, the booster is in microgravity or free-for-all conditions. Although it's quite expected that it will take SpaceX several more months to refine Raptor V2's design into something ready for flight and to construct and qualify at least 33 of the engines, Booster 7 has begun cryogenic proof and wet dress rehearsal testing in the meantime. Elon Musk, the company's chief executive officer, has stated that Booster 7 will first fire up just one or a couple of its Raptor engines. In all of SpaceX's history, the company has never started more than six Raptor V1 engines simultaneously. It has never tested more than three engines at a time on a Super Heavy rocket. In either case, Super Heavy B7 will explore a substantial amount of uncharted territory. Even before the actual static fires begin, Booster 7 will need to finish one or more wet dress rehearsals, WDRs. A WDR is a test that precisely duplicates a launch, but pauses just before the moment when the ignition occurs. If SpaceX were to undertake a full wet dress rehearsal, in which the booster would be filled with more than 3,000 tons of liquid oxygen and liquid methane, it would not only be a first for Super Heavy, but it would also be a significant test of the orbital launch site. In order to pressurize the rocket's propellant tanks, Booster 7 will need to perform tests on its autogenous pressurization system. This system uses hot oxygen and methane gas in place of helium to achieve the desired level of pressure. What do you think of this new Booster 7? Let us know in the comments section below. Thank you for watching today's video till the end. Make sure you subscribe to this channel, like this video, and switch on notifications so you don't miss out on any of our incredible videos. See you in the next video. Bye.